Blackstone presents American Comics, A History by Jeremy Dauber. This book is read by Jeremy Dauber. To Talia, a marvelous miss who I know will become a wondrous woman. Introduction, Birth of a Medium. Our story starts, appropriately enough, with a bang. The whiz of shells, the crack of gunfire, and an artist crouching beneath them, getting it all down. Thomas Nast may no longer be a household name, but during his lifetime, he shaped the course of a war and set fire to the American imagination, and the themes his story illuminates sound familiar to anyone appreciating comics. Humble origins leading to remarkable successes, surprising leaps, if not in a single bound, of artistic ambition, and, yes, weaknesses, with great power, great responsibility, and Nast's precedents weren't all good ones. Nast, like so many others in our story, was an immigrant. His father was forced to leave Germany in 1846 due to his socialist stances. Thomas was six, and his eye became attuned to politics early. He got his first job at 15, another theme, autodidacts and early starters, from another recent and recently successful immigrant, Frank Leslie, who was creating a new expanded role in America for drawn pictures with words, comics, for now and for short. Making images that imparted a message is an impulse as old as human civilization. Juxtaposing them sequentially so that the mind put them together to tell a story is almost as old. Proponents and propagandists have dated sequential art making, and thus proto-comics, back to cave paintings. If that feels somewhat dubious, feel free, as some have, to substitute Egyptian tomb paintings, Greek book rolls, Roman tabulae, Mayan ceramic art, Mexican codices, Japanese woodblock booklets, or the 11th century Bayeux tapestry depicting the Norman conquest. Well, that's a contentious and narrative-oriented definition. Comics fans and scholars argue about where to draw the line, pun very much intended. Are comics sequential? Well, that definition excludes all single-panel entrants, from political cartoons to the family circus. Are words necessary? Many great comics don't have them. Perhaps we ultimately define comics as, in one critic's words, objects recognized by the comics world as comics, ostensibly tautological and also correct. There's general consensus, for example, that children's picture books aren't comics, despite meeting the criteria set out in many of the definitions. But juxtaposition of text and image have been crucial, if not strictly essential, to the history of sequential comic storytelling, which took a sharp turn with the development of the printing press. Broadsides, or broadsheets, which reached their height in Western Europe and its colonies between 1450 and 1800, often featured an image or series of images with separated text above or below. Printing allowed these images wide circulation. Newly invented movable type created separability between word and image, not necessarily available to the creators of illuminated manuscripts or woodcuts. Broadsheets could feature general religious instruction or more topical moral polemics. Martin Luther employed caricatures extensively in his campaign against Catholic authorities. He particularly liked 1521's The Passionale of Christ and Antichrist, 13 pairs of woodcuts juxtaposing episodes from Jesus' life with less admirable papal activity. The Catholics did the same, producing a strip during the 30 Years' War entitled Martin Luther, Doctor of Godlessness, Professor of Villainy, Shameful Apostate, God-Robbing Husband, and Author of the Augsburg Confession. And no one forgot the Jews. Early broadsheets featured anti-Semitic iconography and false charges of ritual murder. Salacious crime reporting was popular early on, too. Broadsheets were frequently hawked at early modern public executions. That the sheets required advanced preparation meant the artist's impressions were, well, inaccurate in detail. Sellers soon realized the value in producing material looking on the brighter side, however, and by the 1700s, when broadsheet printing adopted the technology of etching designs onto copper plates, the works were known as comical cuts, a term shortened to the comicals, then the comics. By the 1820s, that technique gave way to lithography, a chemical process that allowed multiple reproductions without loss in quality. The images now produced, often by anonymous toilers, ranged far and wide, high and low. Representations of miracle plays jostled for popular attention with Mr.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.